Team has 30 seconds.
Launch director on countdown one. SpaceX Falcon Heavy, go for launch.
Falcon Heavy is configured for flight.
T-minus 15, standby for terminal count. 10, 9, 8.
Side booster ignition.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Ignition.
Welcome everybody to Sped Austria. First of all, thank you so much for joining us today. You have been probably in endless video meetings the past weeks, and we really appreciate that you showed up. Over 200 people registered for this event with a passion for hardware development. Isn't that fantastic? We have attendees from all over Europe, therefore we decided to do this event completely in English. We are super happy to broadcast live from HEN headquarters in Dornbirn, Vorarlberg, that is obviously in Austria. I'm Linus Grabherr, country manager for Creatize, and your host for what will be an exciting and event filled with discussion, all things from hardware, design, manufacturing, and product development. I'm really looking forward to today's sessions. We have been able to bring world-class innovators to Launchpad. Before I start with my first guest, let me quickly explain you some of the basics about our hosting platform, AirMeet. It is pretty much straightforward. You will automatically connect with the next session on our agenda that you can see on the right side. Sometimes it takes 10 to 20 seconds before the next session is starting. Your camera and microphone will be off during the whole live session. In case you want to further interact or ask questions, please use the chat and question section also on the right side. And don't forget, we have the Beer Tears session at the end of the event. There you have the possibility to join different tables with different topics and ask the questions face to face. But more to that later. I know you are all excited now. Let's don't waste time and let's go set. Our first guest is Martin Ohneberg. He's the CEO of HEN, an innovative Austria thought leader in the field of hardware and manufacturing, who we also would like to thank for allowing us to host this event in this wonderful headquarter with the stunning mountain background. You all know we now have April and the weather is always changing. Now it's sun again. In the morning it was snow, but I think that's usual time for this. Martin will give us his views on future vision and growth opportunity in a post-corona world. As the captain behind this large hardware business, he has unique insights into these topics and can offer some clarity in these uncertain times. I welcome Martin Ohneberg.
Thank you very much, Linus. I also say hello to everybody. I'm very proud to have the chance to host this event at our headquarters in Vorarlberg at HEN. As I said, we are still in winter time. We had summer some days ago. Now it's winter, and we hope summer is coming again. We also hope that we overcome this COVID situation and so that we all come in a good mood for the future, because good mood for the future means all innovation, and innovation means growth and a good and healthy development for our companies. I was asked to give a little bit an introduction about HEN on the one side, also about the business model and also our thoughts for the future, what is innovation for us and how we deal with innovation, how we treat this subject to be also successful like we were in the past. So the HEN Group today, HEN Group is more or less 90% of HEN business is done in automotive. Automotive is a very strong, very hard business, especially in these days, because we have different challenges in this field of business. And actually, this year we plan around 130 to 140 million with more or less 450 employees. When I took over the company at the beginning of 2011, the company had sales of 19 million and 225 employees. So we had a very, very nice growth in the past. And of course, as the owner and the CEO, you want to grow also in the same manner as you develop in the past. So this is, of course, it's a challenge for HEN. As I said, we are in the field of automotive, and of course, we also forced to do and to develop other things. So what is HEN doing? HEN is, the main product of HEN is couplings. So we produce couplings out of plastic and also out of a mixture of steel and plastic. We call it, it's a hybrid solution. We are in applications for turbocharging and also heating and water couplings. This is the main business, and we also produce safety parts for the automotive industry. We serve the whole world with our product. Actually, we have more than 36 OEMs. So all OEMs more or less are using products from HEN. We have different locations. We have production sites in Germany. We have also a production site in China. We have rep and sales offices throughout the world in Japan, in China, also in Korea, in US and Paris, and we serve the rest of the European market, especially the German market, out of this headquarter in Vorarlberg. So we are doing a lot of research and development. We spend around 5 to 6% on the yearly sales in research and development, and we have an extensive patent strategy. At the moment, we have registered more than 200 patents on a global scale. For us, it is really very important to register our patents. Why? Because we have big competitors, multinational companies, and of course, they try also to be successful in our field of business. As I said, at the moment, we do 90% of our business in automotive, and we also want to do and want to grow in automotive in the future. But on the other side, we also decided to grow in other field of business. The big headline, the big vision of HEN also for the future, for the next 10 to 20 years, is to become a dominant leader in coupling, in the coupling industry. And not only coupling, we say it should be smart couplings. What do we understand with smart couplings? We are not only producing the couplings, as I said, out of different materials, we also do the crimping machines. You need the crimping machine to crimp the coupling on a hose. This can be rubber, this can be metal, this can be plastic. So we not only deliver the hardware, the product, we also deliver the hardware together with the process, with the crimping process. And this is something really unique what HEN is doing. And in this, we are one of the only companies are doing that. And this is what we call, this is a USP. This is a unique selling proposition. And when we started this process in thinking about what we can do in other field of business, based, of course, on innovation, we said, what is the best? The best is to transfer a successful business concept into another field of business. So it's very important to understand what is the USP. The USP is a unique selling proposition, and it's a simple word. Many people use it. But if you go in detail and to understand what is a USP and what is the difference between a USP and a core competence, then you understand what is really a big advantage for a company to be successful also in the future. As I said, HEN has a USP. One big USP is that we not only produce the coupling, we also do the crimping machine. So we sell a process together with the product. So we said we also want to do this in other field of businesses. And last year, during the COVID situation in the beginning of the year, in the first half year, we, with an external company, we were able to finalize a strategic project where we said to be successful also in the future, we have to have new businesses. So the answer and the result of this was, on the one side, we want to grow vertically in our business where we are today. So this is automotive, and horizontal. This means in other field of businesses, for example, aerospace, for example, food and beverage, other field of businesses. So, and we have defined some of them. And now we started with a concept on the one side on organic growth and on the other side on an M&A approach. And during the COVID phase at Christmas, we were able to fulfill part of our strategy in M&A. So we bought in December, we bought the company in China, a production company. It's a normal injection molding company, a plastic company. And this is important for us because in the future, we want to also produce our couplings out of plastic out for the Asian market from Asia. So this was an important part of our strategy to serve not only the coupling out of metal, also to serve the coupling in future out of plastic. So we have one production site besides Europe, also in Asia. And second, we were in a very good situation that we were able also during this period to buy another company in nearby, 2.5 hours from here in Stuttgart, nearby Stuttgart. We were able to buy a company, they are focusing on couplings, you know. So the same what we are doing, but they are only 10% of their business is in automotive. So they are doing 90% of their business is out of automotive. And this is the ideal platform for us for the future to grow, not only in automotive, but also in non-automotive, like food and beverage, like alternative energy, like robotic, like automatization. All big businesses for the future with trends where we know that in the future the growth will be bigger than in other field of businesses. And I think this shows very impressive that we were even able in the situation like the Corona situation that we were able to take advantage out of this and were able to strengthen our strategy in the sense that we did also in this situation M&A transaction. And nowadays, what we are doing is that we started an intensive innovation process in the company. Since the beginning of this year, we also hired a very good guy for this business. He is the innovation manager in our company now, and he's trying together with the project management, but also with the engineers to do new couplings in the field of automotive, of course, and also together with the other companies in other field. And what is the idea? The idea is that we make use of our experience, what we have from the automotive and the other companies from other businesses in the coupling industry. So what is important? Important is that today we have the people doing that. And one of the most important things to be successful in innovation is to have people, you know, the right people, and you need the right team, because innovation is not just something what is handled by an innovation team. It should be done by a team consisting of the market, the sales, because they know what the market is expecting from us. On the other side, the project management, they are responsible for the timing and the cost for this project. Then the innovation management, they look a little bit more over the market in the future. And on the other side, the engineers. And therefore, we have the mixed team. And I think this is very, very important. And if we need someone from the market with special market understanding, we try to hire people either on a consulting basis or as employees, so that we have the right team doing innovation. On the other side, it's also clear that innovation means experimentation. So experimentation always means that you need a budget. You can be successful, but of course it could be also a failure. And I think it's also very important that you accept as a CEO that you accept and you dedicate some budget to such ideas, because it can go in the right direction. But on the other side, you also have the position to that if something is not successful, you have to stop this. You have to stop this immediately, because as it can become very expensive and you lose time. So this is something what you also have to consider. On the other side, you have to consider the culture in the whole company. Why? As I said, it could be that there will be some failure. Without failures, you are not able to be innovative. And I think this is also something you have to accept as a CEO and also as a shareholder in the company. And also what is important in that you work together with companies like Creatize, because they are flexible, they have completely new business models, And especially in this prototyping developing phase, it makes sense that you get parts for different applications in a fast manner and in a short, especially in a short time. And this is also something completely new for us because it's a new player in this market, and you start to work with other companies together. On the other side, you also have to set clear boundaries where the people have to go. It not be just open that you say it's go and make your innovation in fields where you think we could be successful. We have to give a guideline for this, and we gave this guideline with our project, with our strategy, where we said where we want to be in 2035 in the businesses. Of course, we have to check this, but if we think that this is right, then we have to invest in this. And as I said, what is the most important thing is the people, and what we are also trying, and you can see with this room also, it's our think tank. You have to be a great place to work, and our understanding is that the people have to be successful. People have to be they have to feel confident in the company, and they have to go the way with us in sense of being emotional enough to be successful. I think it's also something what is really very important to be successful. And at the end, I think for everybody has to understand the sense of urgency. You know, as I said, automotive is really changing. The business is changing. We know with our existing products, we can grow also in the next 5-10 years, but nobody knows where it goes after these 10 years. So we said very clearly, we have to find new segments, new businesses where we also want to be successful. And we have to find this, and we are really on the right way to do that, especially in the first two segments we started. We already have the first concept and product ideas, and we believe that we can be successful in this. And therefore, it's really important days like this to think about what means innovation, which culture you need, which products you need, how you can help to get the products. The time to market is very important. To be fast, you have to be faster than the others. And I think this is something what we were able to show in the past. We have to show that we can do this also in the future. And therefore, we are working on that. And yeah, this was my short introduction. Thank you very much, and the best for this day.
Thank you, Martin, for this super insight. We now have Simon here, live broadcasters from Berlin. He has some more questions. Simon Tüchelmann is CEO and co-founder from Creatize. Please, Simon. Hi, Simon to Berlin.
Hi, everybody. Hi, Martin. Thank you so much for the very interesting talk. Really inspiring what you have done. And from talking to you, I know this is only the beginning. You have big plans, and I really hope that things work out or even go above the plan. And especially what is cool to see that you not only survived this crisis, but you come out stronger. Maybe one topic that you also touched on, like, can you give us or the participants and the attendees, can you give us an idea how did you transform Hen to an innovative company, you know, that accepts failure, that has this innovative culture? Maybe do you have like a couple of three to five short advices that you can give for CEOs or innovate or people in product development from your experience in the past years?
Yes, as I said, yeah, the first, you have to be open-minded for new ideas. I think that's important. The second thing is you have to dedicate budgets to them mm-hmm. that they know they can do and invest for prototypes and other things in this with this money. I think that's really very important. The third thing is that you have to understand where you want to go. You have to understand the market, because it doesn't make sense just to be innovative and not to be successful on the market. So this is also something I think it's to think on the other side, on the outside of the box, you know, because we are all in the daily business. So you have to find place and people that have time to think in other ways. So we realize this, for example, not far away from here, we have Hen Next building. where we do all these future projects. It's just 20 meters away from the headquarter, and people can go there with other people to sit together and to discuss about new ideas. As I said, the culture is very important, the failure culture, because it's a phase of experimental. You can be successful or not. So you, of course, you need a strong balance sheet also to do that, not to lose all your equity. This is the precondition. And of course, and this is also, I think, very important, you have to start such processes in a situation where you can afford it. If you can't afford to be innovative, because innovation also costs money, as I said, and wait too long, if the market is going down and you're not able to earn money anymore from your existing business, then this can become quite difficult. And therefore, you have to start at the right time with this, but you have to find the right momentum, because people still in the company say, hey, come on, our growth is good, our business is good, our earnings is good. Why we should do something different? And this is what I think it's very important, this sense of urgency, so that people understand we have to start now to be successful in the future.
Mm. Yeah, really interesting. Can you give us an example of, you talk about failure and you talk about budget and accept losses. Do you have like a accounting way of looking at how much did you lose with innovation and how much did you win? Is there something like this at HEN, or how do you look at this?
No, of course we have, there are some budgets that we know this we can afford, you know, without becoming issues for the other business, because of course you have to dedicate the money for the existing one, and you have to dedicate something for the future. But there is no percentage or something that of course we have some in general. We have ratios where we said, okay, what should be the maximum leverage of the company, a net debt EBITDA figure, or what is the cash flow in relation to the sales. These are important indicators, and these are the basis, of course. And we are still small enough, we are still flexible enough that we can make direct decisions. So of course it depends on the business. If we are successful in the existing one, we can spend more in the innovation. And I think what is important for this is it's not a short-term vision, it's a long-term vision, because of course I can show better result also if I not spend money in innovation, but I want to be also successful in the next 20, 30 years. So we have to invest now. And for me, it's not an issue not to be as profitable like other companies at the moment. They are just making use out of their existing one.
Mm-hmm. Makes sense. I mean, these days, and you also talked about this, a lot of people talk about electromobility, and we have an important event coming up. Mercedes-Benz is launching its EQS on Thursday this week. And a lot of people say that this will change a lot, and will actually change the whole manufacturing landscape and a lot of the small and medium-sized businesses. What are your key strategic drivers at HEN, and what's your take on electromobility?
No, of course, I'm sure that electromobility will be the future, but in which direction, I think it's completely open. It really depends also on the regional side. Do we just speak about Europe? Do we speak about US and Asia? I think the development on a global scale will be different. And still, I think the game is not at the end. Probably, for example, the Chinese, they still invest big money also in the efficiency of combustion engines. It could be that they switch at a certain time to fuel, synthetic fuels, you know, because they know that, for example, nuclear energy is CO2, that is less, or is no CO2
emissions,
and it could be possible they are switched to something else. So I think for a small company, it is important at this time to be flexible on different engines. On the other side, we have started already. We are already in some energy in some electric cars.
the reason why we started also with plastic connectors, not only out of metal. We have a lot of projects also in the fuel cell, for example. So we are in this business, but of course not in the same way like we are in the turbocharging business. Still, turbocharging is increasing on a global scale, especially in US and Asia. So we will have also a nice growth in the future. But we started already, and of course, it's a new game. Why it's a new game? Because also new competitors are starting in this field, because the electric car from the future, they have less products in the car, so the competitors are increasing, because everybody looks how they can go in another field of business from the competitors. But we are in already, and we are working quite hard to be as same successful than in the existing one. And what is, in my opinion, it's also not the electric car from today, it's not the car from tomorrow, because it's still not industrialized. You know, the quantities are quite low compared to the existing combustion ones. And as soon as they get, they have to be forced to be more industrialized, I'm sure that they are more interested in standards, they're more interested in reducing manufacturing costs, so that this will become, you will get new chances. So to be always on the market, to look what other people are doing, and to start already doing new things like we did already in the past.
Great. Maybe one last question, because we are broadcasting from Austria. Where do you think Austria is excellent in hardware product development, and where do you think there are big challenges ahead?
No, I think the portion of the industry in Austria is quite high. It's more than 20%, and we saw after the crisis in 2007 and 2008, all countries with a high level of industrial production or manufacturing, they recovered faster than the other ones. But on the other side, I think it becomes more and more difficult, because the global developments, like the location of production, in my opinion, becomes more and more important, because of all these national movements. Like in China, they said they want to be responsible for their own in the next 5 years, so not depending anymore on others. Of course, US is trying to reduce their trade deficit in US first. I'm sure Biden will do the same, because he has to support his manufacturing. So I think for so small and medium companies like HEN, in the future it becomes more and more important to have manufacturing sites also in the countries, like we bought in China, we're looking also in US. I think it becomes more and more important than the past, and also becomes more difficult to close the trade agreements. Still, we had the European Union has no agreement with US, or the new one not, and others, it becomes more and more difficult. So, and on the other side, of course, the lack of talents becomes more and more difficult, the fight to get the right talents. Of course, also, we are all suffering from the debts out of this crisis, so we have to see how we will reduce debts in future. We have to reduce all these the expenses for people, because taxes in Austria are too high compared to others. So we have our challenges, but the good thing is that still education is not bad compared to others. Still, we are a rich country, so we should be able to invest in new ideas. But competition is increasing. We are around with very good, very successful countries like Baden-Württemberg, Bayern. So we are always in a fight to become better, and we have to work on that too.
Great. So big challenges ahead, also opportunities, global and local at the same time. Martin, I wish you good luck. I hope you stay around and enjoy the other sessions. And thank you so much for hosting us.
Thank you very much for the possibility. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Martin Ohneberg.
Thank you, Simeon. Greetings to Berlin. We have like a full agenda of new speakers are coming up, so we have to stick to our plan a little bit. Don't get confused with the name that is still on the surface. That will change in the next session. we heard like what a great talk it was, like, and a start to this event. Now we will continue with a series of discussion with experts on their respective successes and failures. First up is Niels Berger. He's the CEO and owner of Vienna-based Viewpoint System, who will discuss with Thomas Hofmeister, with our CCO of Creatize, about his experience with failures and successes while leading his enterprise. Then we will have the pleasure of sharing an interview with Philipp Sonnleitner. He is the co-founder and CIO of MikeMe, which is Austrian startup behind the great microphones we are using in Balingen and also in Berlin today to broadcast this live event. Thank you, Philipp, for providing us with top sound quality. Philipp will tell Tommy about his ups and downs while working to develop a game-changing web product. Thirdly, we will hear from Sot Meer, our CSO of Creatize, as he discusses the design to X approach with Philipp and how this approach can be very useful when developing an innovative hardware product from scratch. The next session will start in automatically in like 10 seconds. So just stay there and I see you at the other side. Thank you.